Man like Rio.
What's happening?
How are you, brother?
I'm good.
Now, I've never actually done this before, but I thought this time around I'll do it.
Because I've never seen you with
cards.
Cue cards like this.
Yeah. We're trying to get professional right
real,
now.
Isn't it?
It's before, it was just my phone, a little bit, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I'm trying to go BT, take your place. So, Premier League winner, Football League Cup winner, even won the Community Shield, Champions League, FIFA World Cup. To me, the most impressive though, the Intertoto Cup at West Ham.
Yeah, sometimes people leave that one out. They shouldn't.
They can't leave it out. It don't even exist no more. So it's vintage. It's like...
It's the first. Yeah, man.
Do you even remember it?
Yeah, I remember. Was it Mets we played against?
I don't remember it. I can't lie to you.
We played Mets as one of them. We went to somewhere like in Croatia, Osijek. Yeah, I remember. It was a good experience.
I remember you went... Young size would have been you. What, Frankie was there as well?
Me and Frank were the young ones. And then you had like Paul Kitson, John Artson. People like that.
Kitson.
Bad players.
John Artson. Aggressive.
He was a proper player. He's the only player I see like manhandle soul. Like
but properly. He just seems like the type of guy. Physicality was a big part of his game. I remember when he came to
you
Arsenal.
You know one of them, man, that when you got other players that are in the gym, they go gym to build strength and that. And like, oh, I've done 100 kg on the bench press. Brilliant. He'd come in and just do that as a warm up, quick, boom. Never going in the gym, never doing nothing in the gym, just naturally, like, tonk.
Wedge man. Reminds me of my brethren that come over from Albania when I was in school. When you play football with them, then they wore shoes to kick ball. We're wearing football boots.
In your shins.
What? Man, we kick it from 30 yards, stop being stone pipe. Do you know what? It's funny that I was going to start off by talking about England, but we've started by talking about John Hartson, his physicality. Because we knew you was a great young talent. And Resi football, and I think Premier League football at the time, there was a massive difference I always saw. Resi football was a little bit slower when I went to go watch it. And then the Premier League football was intense. What was the first striker you played against where you're like, welcome to the Premier League?
Do you know what? It's mad. I went to, I was in a testimonial for Alvin Martin at Upton Park.
Okay.
And we played Chelsea. And at that time, I was about 16, enough hype. People saying, yeah, he's got to play. I think I was 16 or 17, just turned 17. Enough hype, you should play. Then I came on and Chelsea had Mark Hughes up front, right? And I was at that age, obviously, I was always trying to nick in front, the ball coming to the striker, I'd nick in front because I was quick and nimble and then go and start an attack. Skill. And the ball got rolled into him and I thought, right, I can nick that. I tried to go around the side, snuck round, went to get it, but my man just went, boof, with his arm. And I was on the floor.
Serious?
Yeah, I just That's got true. Laid out on the floor. And then at that moment, I went, rah, I'm not ready yet. This is different. Like, the strength, I've got to build some strength up. Like, that's a man now. I'm playing against a proper man, seasoned player. And it just made me sit and just check myself a little bit. Because all I've been doing was that
yeah.
the whole way. Everyone, great stuff, positive. And then... That happened and I just thought, no one would have even noticed or see it. But inside, I just thought, there's still a way to go. I'm nowhere near ready yet. Because I thought I was ready at that time.
Oh, you thought you was ready. But then when you get the introduction and the testimonial,
yeah.
you see that.
Yeah.
So then you made your debut. At what age did you make your debut then? You're 16 years old.
17. The end of that season.
End of that season. What was it like? What did you do from the testimonial up until the point when you made your debut when you realised, I've got to prepare myself a little bit better for this situation?
No, it's just being more aware. Like, just don't think you can just ghost round people. They're not going to try and stop you. Or, like, with the younger players or in the reserves, I could ghost round people, and by the time they've reacted, I've gone. Where these seasoned players and the proper first teamers, they're understanding where you're coming. And it's the mental game as well, isn't it? If I'm playing against the centre forward, I used to touch them on the left shoulder sometimes and come around the right. You know what I mean? When the ball's coming into them or vice versa, I'd bang them on the side, this side, and I know I'm going to come around this side. And if, by the time I bang them there, they do that. But I've gone this side some of the time. So playing games like that, I started learning stuff like that over time. Can't become, not easier, but it becomes a game of chess, really.
So it's like you're a young player, a lot of hype, like you said, come into the side. I had a mate, my dad's friend, Jim, I tell you what, he loved you. You, Michael Carrick, Joel Cole, any young player, he was convinced that you lot were the Ajax of East London. And he just said, look, we have the best squad player, we have the best young players coming through and so on and so forth. At what point would you, because he thought you were dope from day one, he said you had everyone in pockets. At what point did you say, wait a minute, I'm coming to terms with the Premier League. What was the opponent where you're like, I'm a little bit fearful of him because I know how good he is, but you had him at pockets at a young age?
Probably Les, you know.
No way.
Yeah,
30?
It's probably Les. We played at Upton Park, and obviously it's like they was billing it like Les playing against Rio. Les is obviously like, is it Spurs then? Smashed it at Newcastle, smashing it at Spurs, England, etc. One of the best, probably three or four or five strikers in the league.
100%. The haircut was a howler.
Howler. But he was still slick as they come. He was like 007, man, he was.
Serious?
Yeah, slick Rick. And then the game come, and I just played well. I just like, I don't think he really got a chance on goal, but I just played really well that game. And it was a moment where I felt I'm ready to play and keep playing at this level now and to go on. You know what I mean? I think Dion Dublin was another one as well when he was at Coventry. And to be fair, he came up to me on the way off the pitch and said, Rio, you keep playing like that, anything's possible.
I'll tell you what, he had a good little spell, Dion Dublin. Got the move to Aston Villa, 98-99.
He's playing up front, you can't defend him. He's just too good in the air. Had a wicked touch, and if you gave him space, he could bang it from anywhere. Dion Dublin was a mad player. Good player, man.
I don't remember many young centre-backs your age with that type of impact until maybe Micah Richards years later. But I don't really remember any centre backs like that.
A bit different though. Please don't. You can't say that.
I'm sorry. I do apologize.
Mika, come on.
Mika, you're my brother, but obviously technically you're
different. They were different. He got in the team. He's the youngest defender to play for England, isn't it?
He broke your record.
Yeah. He was sick.
Now I remember when you were in the team. I was talking.
But he was like pace, strength.
Who, Mika?
I was a bit more guy, wasn't it?
This is some real like I'm better than you thing. BT versus Sky.
No, I'm loving it.
I remember the England game though, only because Jim just kept bragging about West Ham players, and then you got the call up. I remember the big back TV in my living room, we're watching it with my dad and Jim. And I only found out today who you came on for. The pub question, like you said, you came on for the current England gaffer. What is it like being a young player for England, getting that type of opportunity under them circumstances? What are the major differences to a club experience?
It's because you're one of the best in England. You're not one of the best in your club. You're one of the best in your country. Like, and to get recognised at a young age as well, and you're there, and it all comes together at that point. Like, people that have been on that journey with you, the most important people on that journey were in the stadium that night. My mum, my dad, my coach, who was my district manager, Dave Goodwin, and a few other people. But like,
did Anton get the call up?
Anton was too young, I think. Because he might have been there. But it's like, you go there and it all just comes together, man. You're sitting there going, and you're standing there and you're in the stadium. And then to be fair, I was warming up on the side a few times and the whole crowd was singing my name.
Serious?
I was thinking, I've never played for England yet. I've never even played yet. But these like shivers. And then Gareth Southgate obviously goes down injured. And I don't care what anyone says, you sit there and go, yes.
Is it?
Yes. Like, get me on there. I was buzzing, but obviously you've injured, but you're going to be fit again. Not a serious injury, hopefully. But if you're all honest, you know that this is what happens. You do say that. And then I went on, man. It was just a beautiful feeling, man. It's like you're running on cloud nine. You're just running on thin air. Like, you just feel light, and I didn't feel no pressure, and that's probably because of age. You're fearless.
Sort of just go for it, not have to worry. It's a friendly game. It's at Wembley. You got Scholesy playing, so you know we're going to get a goal or two. It finishes 2-0. What is now the expectation for yourself? Because you said, all right, cool, 16 years old. I know I'm good. You play a testimonial. Mark Hughes shows you, but you're still a little you out here. You then get really as Ferdinand in pockets. You're playing for England right now. Where's your mentality? Where's your state of mind at now?
I was on the crest of a wave, man, and I was just like, I was overindulging in everything you could imagine off the pitch.
Serious?
Every party I was invited to, guest list, all my boys, guest list, everywhere
you
roll up,
what
everywhere,
parties
no queues, any party.
There must have been some
North, west,
bait
south,
ones in south,
east, I used to travel anywhere.
What was a bait party in south? I'm trying to think.
Nah, the best place was Colosseum, bruv.
Colosseum? Where was that?
Like, near Vauxhall Bridge. Bad. People come from everywhere to go there. North, east, south, west, everything. That's the first place that I went where you used to have to go like through the metal detector to get in there. It used to be madness in there. It used to be crazy. Like, so metal detectors, the maddest security from around London used to be on the door. Old guy called Mr. T. He's like Mr. T. Some hard back brother. And then you used to have like, it was just, even going toilet was a mission. Like, because you're thinking, right, I'm going to go toilet. And there's man from all parts here.
anyone could walk in the
tournament. Yeah, it's like it used to be mad. And Laserdrome, for the older heads, a place called Laserdrome in Peckham.
Peckham.
Like jungle, drum and bass. Mad, cold place.
But isn't it a bit weird? Because you're Rio Ferdinand, and them times, the gap between fame and, let's say, normality for conversational sake, is huge. Mm. If you're on TV, man are screaming.
Mm.
So when they see you and you're that accessible in a dance in Peckham, was it a respect for what Rio had done, or was it ever a time you felt uncomfortable?
No, you know the maddest thing, people always say that, well, you're like, what, you go there, you... I always feel comfortable in them environments because that's where I'm from. Mm. And like, because I was going to them places before people really knew me.
Yeah.
To see me in there once I'd kind of bust through was normal. Like, are you still coming? Actually, you know what? I respect that you're still coming back. That's the kind of vibe I felt. Like, because there's not a lot of people probably make it and go, you know what? I can't go there now.
Mm.
Where I was more like, that's my music. That's my culture. And that's the type of people that I feel best around.
Mm.
This is what I'm used to. So I'm going to continue going there just because I made it. And all my friends as well. I'm not going to go to some other place, upmarket place, where my friends don't like going. We don't even like the music, don't like the people. I would mix and match it. I'd go nice places, but then I used to love going to the places where people would say, oh, what are you doing in here? Why are you in it? But I felt comfortable there. Do you know what I mean? I took some players there, enough players.
Who'd you take? I was just going to ask you, what West Ham players did you take? Should have taken Julian Dix. John Hartson.
I went with England. What? So we met up with England on it. We used to meet up after the game on a Monday. No, Sunday. We'd meet up you could meet up on a Sunday and you were allowed to go out.
Yeah.
And then train on Monday. And I remember we said, yeah, come. Righty, man. Let's take some of them to Coliseum. I don't know if Righty had been there yet. And he said, yeah, okay. So I said, like Incy, Steve McManaman, Robbie Fowler, Jamie Redknapp, come, let's go. But this is what people don't understand. They come in there and everyone's going, what are these men doing in here? Oh my God. Like, I can't believe you're here. Respect. Like,
dope though, isn't it?
It's unbelievable. These guys, I speak to Macca about it now. He laughs. Like, so I just caught him. I didn't know where I was going. I just went in. It was fine. But people loved us in there. It was unbelievable. But like, people would assume, right, they're going to get moved to, or someone's going to say something.
Of course.
But listen, it might be different now. I don't know. But in them times, you go to places where people don't expect to see you. More time, it's like, you know what?
Respect, man. Good on what you're doing, type of thing. That's what you kind of want to see, man.
It's also how you carry yourself.
Ah, true.
As well, like, if you're going to go in them places and try and floss and try and be the guy and show people I am that guy and I'm... People then will take it differently. And I think you'll get dealt with differently. But I was never like, I'll just go in there to enjoy myself with my friends, doing what all other guys my age wanted to do, is listen to music, get jokes, and then you know the rest.
You was on a blending thing, so you were blending in. The only reason you stood out was because you was Rio Ferdinand.
The only time I stood out was in the VIP crew to get in the front of the queue, to get in the place.
I weren't on queues, man.
That's the only bit that I just was blessed about. I didn't queue nowhere, I was lucky. Very rarely up to queue anywhere.
I'll tell you what, people, before we move on, I have to tell you, in 2016, I remember going to see Rio in a dance, and it was with Alan Shearer, and I saw Alan Shearer dancing to Blurred Lines. That is the best.
Where's this?
In Paris. I will never forget. I said, where are you, Rio? He's like, I'm coming. I come down the stairs.
Yeah.
I know you want you. And I see Alan Shearer dancing in between the beat, which I think is a talent. And I'm like, yo, big man, keep up with the...
Yeah,
fantastic.
That was mad. That them times, them tournaments are unbelievable, man.
But what is it like then? So, for example, because now one thing we hear about is, you know, when young players do have a life outside of football, it's always thrown and it's always a problem. It's always an issue. Not so many cameras back then.
Mm-mm.
Was it easier to cut through?
Bro, I'm so happy I played back in them days.
Oh, right. Did the club ever complain?
Yeah, listen, I got in trouble a lot when I was young. Like, I got into like fights when I was out maybe, and sometimes it's through friends or people just taking the mick or whatever, and you don't react properly, right, like in the right way to it. Or I was going out too much when I was young. Listen, you got to remember, so I'm a young kid, yeah? I'm a young kid, ain't got nothing really, just got a good life on an estate with my family.
Yeah.
Then I get given a bag of money, and then the front doors of every nightclub and rave are open and you're invited everywhere. Any fashion thing that's going on, new bar opening, you get a call. and all my boys wanted to go, I say, I'll go, man.
Because you used to go and get him in.
Yeah, I was going out 4 or 5 times a week. And people ask me, like, and it's like, how could I say no at that time? I couldn't. It's too enjoyable. But the problem is now, that's documented. Everyone's got a phone out and they're viewing it. Whereas I was going out, Harry and that wouldn't know I was out on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Can't film man with a 32-10.
Exactly. But I was out in West London, North London or South London.
You come to our neck of the woods.
Yeah, but and then all of a sudden in East London, he ain't finding out. Or Essex.
Where did you go in North London? Tell me you went Temple.
Know, I don't know. Yeah, I went Temple.
My brother.
Yeah, I went Temple.
So now Rio Ferdinand and Usher have been Tottenham.
Wait, where did I go? Where did I went somewhere else?
Where else?
But it's a bit in more
north.
Like...
In North?
Yeah.
Oh, it wouldn't have been in Tottenham. All we had was Temple and the police station.
Where was Granaries?
Granaries?
Yeah, that's the I have old to ask people, big people.
Loons and Margs and them, man.
That might be like East Side or North East. I don't know. But yeah.
Granaries,
but,
you know?
But it's like, I don't know. It's like... The stuff with going out and the players nowadays, the difference is that there's so much more exposure.
Mm.
They're everything's seen and they're judged. Do you know what I mean? So, and a picture doesn't always tell the true story. Do you know what I mean?
100%.
So people, you could get a snapshot of something and it all of a sudden people think, he's giving it. Look, he's flossing, he's this and that. Really, he was just doing his own thing, minding his own business, but you've caught him at that one moment that looks very different.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? So... It's like Pogba and Jesse, they got a lot of stick a couple of years ago, especially. And they're probably just coming out the back end of it now without being judged by that anymore.
Is that, do you know what? I want to talk a little bit about England early days as well, but staying with that point there, is that a bit harsh, Rio?
I do, I think it's harsh. But you've got to remember, you've got people who are in the media who are controlling the narrative,
mm-hmm.
are old school, and they mm-hmm. see it very different. So they've got to train themselves, we've got to train ourselves to understand the next generation. They're moving very different to the way we did. But they've also got social media, which we didn't have.
So it's a whole different
world
that they're
into. It's a whole different ball game, yeah. So you've got to approach it differently and look at it and come at it differently. I've had to train myself not to be so mad. Like I saw some with Paul and Jesse dancing in the change room and I was like, well, you, not in my time, that's not happening. When you're 6 in the league, no chance. And then I knew they weren't really happy with me saying that.
Serious?
Yeah, so I rang them and spoke to them about it, which is cool. And everything was calm after that. But it taught me to understand them a little bit more. Like, just because I'm smiling on social media, don't mean that I don't feel it.
Yeah, it's just my way of
And there would have been times where we lost, where I went home, and at one moment, I might have smiled about something or had a little laugh about something, but we don't get documented. So it's different. I don't get judged by that.
100%.
Where they're getting judged by it. So I think it took a little bit of learning from them, like what you put out, when you put it out around games. If you've lost or drawn or haven't played well, control it a bit better maybe, but also for the people in the media to reevaluate how you judge these kids.
You can never trust the media, mate. Don't trust us. We're here. Gareth Southgate, you replaced him on your debut for England. Did you ever see him as the gaffer potentially one day? Did he ever show any qualities of wanting to manage the national
side? No, I don't think there's many people you look at and go, I think you'll be an England manager. So I mean, like Ole Gunnar Solskjaer, I didn't think he'd even be a manager, let alone Man United manager.
Mm.
But Gareth was always quite a thoughtful, measured, calm guy. Do you know what I mean? And you could see him definitely being some sort of coach if he wanted to, or a manager. Because he always looked together. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
There weren't no like madness around him. Very, very like measured person. So yeah, I'm not surprised he went into management, but I didn't expect him to be England manager.
Looking at the England side very briefly, we're going into the Euro 2020 and 2021, which is incredible. I've heard you speak about England in the past, and some of the things that you said, I think were very, very honest. The divides in the change room because of the teams, and how territorial, how territorial players were, because if I'm going for the league and I'm playing against Chelsea, again, we're both competing for the league, then we've got national duty. It was very difficult maybe for you lot to sort of, not see eye to eye, but just have that connection because your day-to-day with your Man United boys. That doesn't seem to be the case. I could be totally ignorant. That doesn't seem to be the case today. Everyone seems to be quite together to a certain extent. Could that be the difference in England's progression with a very calm manager, like you said, like Gareth Southgate?
Yeah, that's 100% one of their strengths, that they're together, that they're a team who have been brought up through the youth ranks and they all know each other.
Okay.
Most of them know each other. They're all connected via social media as well. It's another powerful thing. It's like, how many people do you know via social media? Never met them. But then when you link them, it's like, what's happening? Like, you ain't, so like, you've known them for years.
Yeah, mostly girls for me, but I hate
you. But you know what I mean, though? Yeah. So that's how it is with the footballers nowadays. Never met, not even chat to my man, really. Chatted to him over social media, all of a sudden getting England squad. Yeah, what's happening? It's just like, we just know each other anyway. Ah. So they're so much more connected than we were. Like, I might see Steven Gerrard twice in two games a season, and then see him three or four times with England.
That's it now.
That's five times a year, six times a year max. How are you going to build a relationship with him? Do you know what I mean? It's like, it's very different now.
So there's pros and cons definitely for social media going forward. How do you think England can do?
Do you know what? I reserve judgment until they get out of the group, and then I'll see their path to the final. Because if they get out of the group, yeah, which they will get out of the group, could get one of the teams in the group of death. So they could get Portugal, Germany or France in the last 16. So,
listen, the team's good. I've said many times, I don't want to hear about, oh, that team's really... Fam, we gas about Harry Kane. Mm. We gas about Phil Foden. We gas about English football. I don't want to hear this fear factor of anyone. I don't. This is not 2000 where you get knocked out of the group stages, you win one game against Germany. This is not the embarrassment of 2008 where they didn't even qualify. This is 2021. The team is extremely good. I don't think they should worry about opposition to a certain extent like that. I don't even think like there's five great sides in the Euro competition this time around. Whereas back in the day, I felt like the competition was a little bit more fierce. So I don't think that should be a problem for England.
So France?
France, good side. Portugal?
Portugal, good side. Germany?
Good side.
Good side. Belgium?
Okay. I mean, the defence is the same age as Spec. So.
England?
Good side.
Italy.
Now
they're the dark horses.
Dark horse.
They ain't conceded a goal in eight games or something like that, you know. Dark horses.
But they're a dark horse. They're not someone that you go at the start of the competition, you go, yep, definitely gonna.
No, no, no.
So there's not even that many good European sides, I feel personally. So if there was ever a chance for England to capitalize,
yeah, now.
It has to be now.
I just worry about us defensively.
Well, what's changed defensively? Because back in the day, I could reel off defenders from Nesta to yourself to Cannavaro. All across the world, there was always good defenders. How has defending changed over the years?
Simple, isn't it? When you talk about defending now, you talk about a centre-back now.
Mm-hmm.
What's the first question a scout or someone in likes football will say?
As he with the ball at his feet.
That's exactly it. Not can he defend. What can he defend? That's like one of the four, fifth, sixth questions. Is he good with the ball? What's his distribution like? Does he come out of it? I like all that, don't get me wrong.
Cool, you was that type of player.
But I'd please be able to defend your front post. Please be able to get your feet right when the ball's in wide areas, your body position. Like these basic fundamentals. When I watch games now, I don't think these fundamentals are even trained no more. Ooh. With some of the players because big players. Because I see body positions and I see even things like anticipation. Like, it's all more reactive than it's anticipating where the danger is. Like, so the quality of defending I don't think is as good. And I think a lot of the players now, because of the systems and the way the team's set up tactically, some of them don't have to defend as much in a game because they defend much more from the front and higher press. So the ball don't even get to them. They win the ball before it gets back to their area. Sometimes.
It's actually very, very true. And when you're watching football, like I said, in comparison, centre-backs back in the day were leaders to me. Mm. Very much leaders, all captains. All the centre-backs would be the captains, the people that you were, you know, afraid of the most. Today, I don't really feel that, especially about English football, I don't really feel that the centre-backs are the leaders, so and so forth. And I feel like defenders nowadays obviously make much more mistakes. What defenders today would have survived when Rio Ferdinand was playing football? From the English team?
I just think people will be tested differently. You play against two strikers every week. Ooh. So it was 1v1. Me and Vida against Henri and Bergkamp. That's who it used to be. Or against, I don't know, Hasselbank and Good Johnson or Hasselbank and Zola.
Oh, that was difficult.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or even things like Kevin Davis and Djorkaeff. Do you know what I mean?
Bolton.
Dion Dublin and Darius Vassell. You got two men up there playing 1v1. Do you know what I mean? So it was very different, whereas now, you play up there, you've got one striker.
Not if you play Man City.
I know, but that's what I'm saying. You've got one. It's different problems. Don't get me wrong. It is different problems. But it's like me versus you is very... That's like a battle of wills, a battle of nerve, mental. I'm going to keep coming at you every, all game. Watch. I'm on your shoulder all game. I'm with you. So it's different. Different questions that ask of the defenders nowadays. And I don't think... There'll be some of them that will struggle. Some of them will thrive. It's the same. Some of my generation will be able to play today.
Vice versa.
But I would like to see some of these guys having to go 1v1 all game. Or 2v2 all game against some of these strikers.
I always think to myself, because I see Roy Keane on TV right now, had it not been for Micah Richards, he would still be really angry. And I think to myself, well... What centre-backs would have made a mistake in the Man United changing room back in the day? Who would be the first man to get on them? Who would be the first man to get on you if you made a mistake?
My worst game probably in a Man United shirt was against Middlesbrough away. I had a bogey stadium that stadium.
Riverside?
Riverside was my bogey stadium.
Why?
I don't know, just played shit there every time.
Serious?
Yeah, didn't really play well there at all. I got subbed there. My only time I think I've ever been subbed.
With Middlesbrough?
Yeah. And... I remember Roy Keane saying, he actually didn't say it to me, he said it on a video. Remember when the time when it happened with Matt Sir Alex Ferguson, that whole thing?
What?
When he left Man United?
Yes.
He done a video, didn't he? Where he's analysing the game. One player each week would analyse their game at the weekend on TV or MUTV.
Yeah.
He done it and we got beat by Middlesbrough and he said, Rio was rubbish basically in this game. But like, Roy was. He'll be onto you if you were shit.
Serious?
Yeah.
Is there any incidents in the changing room where someone was kind of onto you at a certain point for having a bad performance or a mistake or something that cost you something quite big?
No one really got onto me. Roy got onto me one or two times. My first cup final in the Carabao Cup, it was called, what was it called back then?
The Caribbean Cup. Oh, the League Cup, Coca-Cola Cup.
League Cup. Coca-Cola Cup, I think it was.
Worthington Cup?
Worthington. So we played there.
They're drink sponsors, isn't it?
We got beat by Liverpool. Michael Owen scored. I didn't play that well that game either. And then I remember coming off the pitch, Roy was going like, giving me some of my first season.
Serious?
Yeah, going like, fucking this, that, the other. To be fair, I had a little go back in because I forgot about it. But Danny Murphy, I see him a little while after, and he said to me, oh, you two are fucking going at it, man. But I didn't mind that. Some people would fold under that type of stuff. I used that type of stuff as fuel. I would have a go back, and then it would be like, right, watch when I go out and show you now. That was my whole mentality, where some would be like, just their heads would go between their shoulders a little bit and don't like that confrontation. But I don't mind that. And I always used to think, if it's for the right reasons, that's it. If I feel you're being vindictive or it's personal, then I don't like that. But if I know it's for the betterment of the team, and that's how I was when I was like a captain or a team member, any team I played in, I was always onto people for the pure basis of the team needs to be doing better and you're part of that, so you need to fix up.
Man, I don't know. I look at players now, I think, I don't know, who would have survived in that changing room? Because Man United, that time that you played, they had so many captains. It didn't matter that Roy Keane had the armband.
Yeah, no.
Vidic was a captain to me, or you was a captain to me at the time. Everyone was a captain. And you went through generations of loads of different players taking, you know, ownership and taking on the role of a captain without the armband in that sort of team right there. Is that something you always had with you, in, no matter what? I noticed it more at Leeds. I didn't see it so much at West Ham, but at Leeds you definitely took on sort of like a leadership
role. Yeah, some people say like captains are just born, but it ain't always like that. Some captains are just like Tony Adams was just, he come out of the womb a captain.
He's a leader, innit?
Do you know what I mean? But some people grow into it. I was more of a grower.
Pause.
I kind of left. At school I was a leader. And then I got into the club and they were saying you got to talk more, communicate, etc. I didn't talk enough. And it weren't until I learnt my game, and it was weird, I went to a World Cup 2002 and something happened. The penny just dropped and I was just talking constantly. Nicky Butler used to turn around and go, Rio, shut up, man. And like moving him in front of me, left, right, up, drop back here. Danny Mills, like, I had it like a bit of string, pulling people about. It just happened. And then that's when I felt I became a leader, a proper leader. But I was already a leader at West Ham, Leeds, but I was captain at Leeds.
Yeah.
But I became a proper someone who could lead and communicate when I went to the 2002 World Cup.
2002 World Cup was a good World Cup. I think that was the one time I looked at the England side good team. Maybe not the balance so much on the wings purely because we didn't have the out and out wingers at the time, but the actual team was a good team. Mm. Got your first goal. I think it was after Denmark, the group stage.
Denmark.
16, Scandinavians.
Last 16s, yeah.
What's the type of mental preparation you got to have for a tournament like that? Because the one thing which is crazy, and it is crazy, you never played in the Euros for multiple different reasons, but you never played in the Euros, but you did play in the World Cup, arguably the biggest competition in football, you know, in the world. What's the mentality and the mindset some of these younger players got to have going into this European competition in order for them to excel past certain stages?
Don't take any of the baggage that comes with social media and people's opinions. Don't take on the pressure. Like, go out there and just do what you... Try and normalise the situation as well.
How can you normalise the situation, though? Like, how do you normalise the situation? Like, you're a real Ferdinand.
Don't look at the media. Don't read all the papers. Don't go on your mobile. I would come off social media for a month if I was them. I would, because human nature is to go on your social media platforms, and human nature is to search and look and see and dwell on the negativity. It's just human. That's what people do. There's very few people that can go on there and just go, bang, negative stuff over there, don't see it, all positive, I'm fine, let's go. Most people see one negative comment out of 100 and focus on the negative one. You've got 99 positive ones. Also, you've got to try and make your life in that bubble that they're in for that month as close to what you're normally doing as possible. The problem we used to have when we used to do it, it was very much like, when do you go and sit in your bedroom for six hours a day?
Never.
You sleep for that amount of time, but you don't go and sit there in your bedroom for 6 hours a day, 7 hours a day. That's what you do when you go to England. So it ain't normal. So your body's different. Your body starts adjusting differently and moving differently. Your mental state of play is very different if you're doing that. So try and get out, go shop, go coffee shop, go for a walk, whatever. Try and normalise it and keep it as much to your normal life as possible.
One thing we'll say about defending is your old, again, I just feel like the era of you, that older centre back, is just amazing. I think they are so needed in this game. And I think
they ain't got the depth now, have they?
No. And one player that, again, I have to give credit to Seagull, always talks about. I asked you about him. You said, yeah, you should have signed him. Johnny Evans. Now, he's at Leicester City. Mm. What qualities did you see with Johnny Evans when he was at United?
He was just calm. He was cool, under pressure, could take the ball. Had the fundamentals down and was a very, very, very good pro. Like, all those basic areas he had covered. Now you could say, I'd walk mind him a bit quicker, but he had speed of thought. He anticipated well. And he was good at adapting to different players, because you have to remember, at the time he was at United, he's having to come in and sometimes fill in for me or fill in for Vida, and he always done it really well. And that takes some sort of football IQ to be able to do that. I said immediately, I told you that's what I said to you.
Yeah, I remember you said it.
Arsenal should have bought him. Any of the top teams outside of Man United, I would have definitely took him, because he's just a good, solid, all-round footballer and a good guy as well.
Seems like a wonderful guy. And when he came out the Leicester City side, all of a sudden, Cianci don't look the same.
Yeah, yeah.
Fofana don't look the same. I'm
makes the others look better.
100%, but he's so subtle about it and so... Just calm. It's not really a hype. He's not really the person. He's only like 8 million on FIFA. I said, great, I'll grab that in. Very, very calm about it. Was that a lot to do with the way in which Man United sort of set out, the defensive coaches sort of set out their defenders to be at that time? Because it wasn't alien for United to have good defenders. Yourself, Vidic, Evra was really, really good at the time.
Well, you look at the young ones that come out of Man United around that time. Johnny Evans, gone on to have a great career.
Yes.
Cathcart had a very good career, played at national football as
well.
Gerard Piqué. No, that's three understudies almost that have gone on to have really, and obviously one of them been a stellar career.
Yes,
Piqué. Like, so it was a good ground for grounding young defenders. But it wasn't just that the club done loads of different drills or training. It was just that they invested in the right kids, and they learnt from people above them, and they learnt from the coaches, and they learnt and they trained, and they saw and worked and smelt and breathed other people's behaviours, movements, etc., and then took it on themselves and done their own thing with it as well. So good time for United at that point to breed young defenders.
I want to stick at your time in United, because I always like to find out all the things that you don't see on Sky Sports News, or you don't see on the net, or you just don't see. One of the things I've always wanted to know is, maybe not now, I reckon they've got systems where they identify players and they bring them in. But surely, Rio, if you're on the pitch and you're playing against players, You know what attackers are dangerous. You know what, hey, he's a good player, he's a good player. You lot must have had an influence in players Manchester United signed. It's well documented that Cristiano Ronaldo, everyone ran back in the change room and said, yo, get that little Portuguese kid. He's a mad thing. Was there any other players that you lot played against that you potentially had an influence in the club signing?
I don't know about influence. But you'd get asked the opinion.
Serious?
Yeah.
What players did you get an asking opinion of?
Like Carrick.
Michael?
Obviously, because I knew him from West Ham. And he was flying at Spurs. I remember the gaffer, he would have took Frank Lampard if he could. But he wouldn't have got him out of Chelsea at the beginning, early doors. For instance, Thiago at Liverpool. Baller. When he left Barcelona, he wanted the opportunity to come to United.
Seriously?
Yeah, but it didn't happen. The club already committed to another player, and then he went to Bayern Munich, but he was someone I think would have come to Man United at that time.
So he was going to go from Barcelona to United? Praise the Lord, it never happened.
Bad player, but like, and then that's when sometimes you get involved, speak to the club, speak to people at the club, the manager, etc. But it didn't happen. But I loved all that because I'm like a fan. I want to see the best players come, and I'm hearing about him. I'm asking Gerard Piqué, "What this boy is? He a good top player?" Yeah, they're saying he's next level. Like, so you're doing all that stuff in the background. And obviously, some materialise, some don't.
What was it like at Man United when a big player came in? I heard Roy Keane used to shoot the ball at you and you see your first touch.
Yeah, stuff like that. You'd want to test him to see. Because like, footballers are quick to judge.
What was it like when you first came to United?
Yeah, it's pressure. There's more pressure in training than the match.
What?
Because you're playing against all these big players you know. Like, he's like a proper player. He's bad. He's got six Premier Leagues. He's got a Champions League. He's like big players everywhere you look.
Yeah, but you've come in. Remember, you did do semi. You got semi-finals of Leeds United, Champions League.
Yeah, but Leeds United and Man United is two different animals.
I couldn't believe you left from Leeds United to Man United in the first place. That was like crazy. And then you've gone to Manchester United. What things did they put you through in the first 2 weeks that make you go, there's a massive difference between this and Leeds United?
It's just the speed of the training. Different. The intensity. Like, every day you're on. There's no days off. It's like little games in training. So, yeah, just, like, madness. You got to win them games. Like, and obviously, it's like me against, like, Ruud van Nistelrooy in training. Like, I'm judging myself now against one of the best two strikers in the league now. I've got to be on every day. Not just coming in and just chilling every now and again. I can go and play up front, messing about in training. No. You just come out. You got to show these guys that you are worthy of being here. They've paid £30 million for you as well. They're looking to see what £30 million brings.
100%. So at West Ham, get the opportunity, bit of money, you're out here. You're in Temple in Tottenham, it's late. Leeds United had a younger squad as well. There was Jonathan Woodgate, there was Lee Bowyer, there was Ian Hart, Robbie Keane, there was loads of players. And I imagine because of that little bit of youth, you might have explored the world as well.
Yeah.
Now you come Manchester United. It's a Scottish man in charge. He was vexed when Aberdeen won the bloody European League, I think they were the UEFA Cup, and he wasn't even happy with the performance. So that's a difficult man to please. Did your private life have to change a little bit in terms of socialising?
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
What did you have to sort of sacrifice?
Sacrifice going out.
Serious, but proper?
Yeah, like, but no, listen, the Man United players weren't saints. They went out, but more time at the right times.
Okay.
Like, you weren't going out two nights before a game. I mean, if you played on a Saturday, you was frowned upon if you were going out on a Saturday night if you've got a game on Tuesday in Champions League. Whereas before, I'd go out on a Saturday, I'd probably go out all day Sunday as well, and then play Sunday League, Champions League on Tuesday at Leeds.
Serious?
Because that was what all the squad were doing, whereas not at United. So to think that I'm going to go out and get leaned up, drunk on a Saturday, come and train on Sunday, when most of them have been in their house just chilling or just having a bottle of wine or glass of wine in their house and they're coming in fresh and I'm going to be baggy in training, your personal pride takes over, your ego. I'm not getting bent up in training for no one.
So what's the preparation difference between a semi-final for Leeds United and a semi-final for Manchester United?
United expect to win.
Leeds are happy to be there.
Yeah. We're shaving our head, enjoying the moment. All of the team shaved their head. I didn't have to because I had a skiffle anyway, but... But what I'm saying is that they're doing all mad things like that. Focus ain't on the game then, obviously. Not completely focused. That and it was crazy. All the players, most of them, first time in the semi-final. And then we get battered 3-0 by a wicked Valencia team.
It was a good side.
But Man United get to a semi-final, it's not about going home. Empty out, you're getting to the final. Expect to get there.
And when you get to the final, you expect to win.
Yeah.
What's the preparation for a final? Because again, that was one of the most, to me, that was one of the most intense Champions League finals with you and Chelsea.
Mm.
It hurts me to say, I was supporting you lot on the day. Sorry, man, then, but I didn't want Chelsea to win. What's the preparation for a Champions League final for Rio Ferdinand when it comes into that game? Because I remember you speaking to me about Cristiano's preparation when we were over in Milan. And you said, bro, he was chill, like he was just relaxed, he wasn't too intense, I had a nice conversation with him. What was it like for you lot?
The Champions League final, I'm not meeting people before and chilling, getting jokes and that. Like, I'd have a laugh with the boys. We used to have these computer things we used to take and play a game called SOCOM, like, a bit like Call of Duty, but for like groups of us on the handhelds.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd play like 4v4, 5v4, till about 9, 10 o'clock, screaming, chatting, competitive. That was our little relaxing type of thing. But listen, Champions League final, man, there's nervous energy flying about. You're trying to get your preparation to be as normal as possible, doing all the things, visualising your performance, visualising the opponent and stuff like that, but expecting to win. You're going out there expecting, that's the pressure you put on yourself. Chelsea was like that. The first Barcelona game, we went into that as favourites.
When you lost 2-0?
Yeah.
How did Messi jump higher than you?
He actually didn't jump higher than me. I didn't jump. The ball just beat me.
Like, that much of a good pass.
This is the difference, yeah? I don't know if I've talked to you about this before, I'm not sure. This is like when it's about doing your, or not doing your research, because my research was always good. It's about in the game, knowing your players and knowing what their capabilities are. So in the Premier League, 9 times out of 10, the ball's out wide with a wide player. In the box, I might cheat at a yard or two. I might cover the front post a bit more because I feel that he ain't really gonna, he's got to do some to get it over my head on the money to that player. Normally he's going to play it a bit short or it'll go too long. But if I get more time, it's going to go short, so I'll just cheat the first yard. I've done that with Messi. I thought he's only 5 foot something. He's fine. He ain't going to beat me in the air if he comes and challenges me. I'll cheat a yard and nick a yard near the front post because he's quick. I want to get there first. And I look up. By the time I realise it's Xavi on the ball, who's one of the best passers in the world.
Come on.
The moment's gone. Now he's in control. He just put the ball on the money. Bang, header. But
was you vexed for yourself?
I knew immediately. As the ball left his foot, I knew. Trouble. Oh no, oh no, oh no. Oh shit.
Did no one get mad at you? Or is it just a sort of
You know what the mad thing was, is the game was done already by then. It felt like we weren't touching the ball. They bossed the whole game. We just didn't feel like we were gonna get in it. That goal in my mind didn't really alter the events of that game. They had us by, like when an older kid at school gets you back of your coat and puts it over your head and they're just controlling you.
It happened once, I won't lie. Yeah, it happened once.
But you know, you see them kids getting just moved about like that and the kid can't do nothing. That's how it felt. We've ever played against Barcelona both times.
You're just getting bullied.
Both times.
The 2-0 one wasn't that bad though. I didn't think it was that bad. The 3-1?
No, the 3-1 was a burial.
That was a disobedient child getting, but that was like my brothers when they went home late. It hurt me because I'm still an advocate of English football. I want to see English
football.
The only
saving grace, the only way that I didn't go even deeper into a mad depression was because when you look at it, it's the best club team ever.
They were ridiculous, bro.
Like, and they got Messi. And I was thinking, you know, if they didn't have Messi, we might have had a chance in this game.
Do you reckon so?
I actually do, yeah. Because he's just them times there.
Ridiculous. What does Ferguson say at full time and in games like that? Because I've heard him say apparently when you're going to play Spurs, it's only Spurs.
Yeah.
You're playing Barcelona. Is there an understanding that Messi is going to do something that could potentially just, we can't defend against?
I saw an interview done the other day when he said that he wished he had a man marked him.
Serious?
With Jason Park, who was brilliant at that. But man marking Pirlo and man marking Messi is two different things. He man-marked Pirlo out of the game in Milan one time. Unbelievable. Like Pirlo averaged something like 80 passes a game, 80 touches a game that season. I think in that game he had about 36 touches after G finished with
him.
But Messi's different. So man-marking him, I don't know if it would have changed the fortunes of the game, but that's what the boss said. But I felt that we didn't get it right tactically in the both of the games. We tried to high press them too much, and we weren't accustomed to doing that. That wasn't the way we played.
So wait, did you say that after the first game as well? Did you ever approach?
Yeah, I said it after the first game.
So what did Fergie say to you if you said it to him?
I didn't actually say it to him though.
Where did you say it?
I was in the change room after.
So you said it to someone else?
No, so like they're always in the change room. There's a few that just linger about in it. Yeah. You just lost the game. You're all down and that, and like sitting there. I think it was me, Michael Carrick, Darren Fletcher, and someone else. And I was just going like, we shouldn't have pressed. Why are we pressing them? We pressed Arsenal. We battered Arsenal, but that's Arsenal. This ain't they're not Barca. We're pressing like, I don't know, it might have been Song and people like that. That ain't Busquets, Xavi, Iniesta, or Yaya and people like that. Do you know what I mean? So, but I went into the game believing it could have been right because I believed in the manager, trusting 100%. And then after I was saying it's wrong, it was wrong. And the mad thing is, that was in the change room after the game in Rome. We played Bayern the season after in, I think, the last 16.
Yeah.
That's like about 8 months later, isn't it? And I didn't agree with one of his substitutions in the game. He brought Scholesy off and brought Berber on to go and try and win the game. And I was going mad, going, what are you doing? Oh my God, no, you can't do that. And I was like, we're 1-0 up, I think it was. We are good at holding a 1-0 lead. We can do that abroad. That's the way we play, and we'll hit you on a counter-attack. We might get 2 now. We went to attack the game, got beat 2-1. And I was going nuts. And I remember Van Bommel looking at me and going, are you okay? I was going nuts, screaming, booting up the wall in the tunnel. And I got to the change room and the manager, I just knew that he heard and
did he go mad?
The hairdryer and some. He just come and stood over me like this and just.
Serious?
And I was going back at him shouting, like, you told us we should play a certain way. You went against your principles. And I remember Gary Neville went to me, we are just leave it like that. And I was vexed. I was like, and I was on the plane on the way home and I was going to Nemanja Vidic, like, I know you know I'm right.
Serious?
And all these men know I'm right and they're just not saying nothing. Leave me just to speak on my own. And I remember Vida went, Rio, how do you think everyone, these people stay here this long? So sometimes you have to just...
humble, chill.
And I was like, nah.
Not on it.
And I slept on it and I woke up and I thought, you know what? Let me go and say sorry to him, man. Because I should have just maybe called him at a different time. Or I shouldn't have argued or shouted on the pitch. I was waving on the pitch, like, what are you doing? That's disrespectful, it is. I woke up and thought that. Went to his office. Knocked the door in the morning about 7:30. The man just unloaded again. he went mad.
He comes like a Jamaican mum.
And the maddest thing, he went, this ain't the first time you've done it, that's why I'm mad. So what do you mean? In the change room in Rome, one of my coaches was in the toilet and listened to you.
And snitching.
You lot was all in there talking about the tactics, so this ain't the first time you've fucking done it. And I was like, rah. Man's got people just sitting, waiting and listening and grassing, but... I get it. It's the way it is. But the difference is, I think he knew that deep down, I only moaned or criticised things because I wanted the team to do well. Because I was obsessed with winning and trying to achieve what we could achieve. So, if he thought that I was doing it for selfish reasons and egotistical reasons, I'd have been gone.
Serious. Mm. What was the relationship like between you two? Clearly, it was been, you know, pretty strong. Brought you over from Leeds United.
Yeah, we had our moments.
Serious?
Yeah, because like, I was passionate about stuff. Like everyone's passionate, but I would outwardly in training. It's mad because in games I was always composed a lot of the time. Mm. I didn't get emotional in the games a lot, other than if we scored.
Like against Liverpool, you went mad.
Yeah, but but in training I would scream and shout at the referee and decisions or whatever. I'd go mad and that. And then sometimes we had disagreements. But again, like I think the only reason I survived at the club, given the number of disagreements that I had, is just because I think he knew that I was doing it from a place of wanting the team to do well.
I think a lot of players, I think one thing it seemed about Manchester United is, well, you did have it, was a strong winning mentality. Like you lot didn't stop until the final minute, the game wasn't over. And it seemed like to be a good and a bad thing because there are a lot of players that they wanted to win so badly, they did end up having arguments with the gaffer. I mean, Roy Keane is very known for not seeming to have a good relationship with Alex Ferguson. Was it Was you the only person in the changing room that was challenging him, or was there other players that were challenged as well? And then you saw the results of that, like, uh-oh, he's disappearing off the back of that.
No, Wazza would have his say sometimes. Giggsy the odd time here and there if the manager got onto him. The people that, like Rude,
yeah,
stepped out of line with him, my man was gone.
What did he
Bex,
do?
Bex the same.
The Bex one hurt me though, man.
Roya the same. And these boys, are other than Roya, the other two were in their prime. But Bex, you step out of line, gone. The culture at the club was about winning every day, like in training. If there was games in training, if your team lost in training, you'd be gunned all day in that training ground. Like, your team, shit, shut up. So try and make a joke. Yeah, but what happened earlier? You got to be shut up, like, just on it all the time.
Come on.
So it's good. And that would happen playing table tennis before training. Like Cristiano, Quinton, Fortune, Nani would play table tennis for a time.
Is it?
Like if someone got beat or whatever, they were, like Cristiano used to get him upset. Where, like, or we'd play basketball, like shoot the basketball before training.
Mm.
Wes Brown used to love that. Darren Fletcher, or we'd play short tennis in there. Like enough stuff.
You're not trying to play pat ball money up. I want to beat everyone quickly.
But like that's what I mean. It was, everything was competitive. Even cards on the journeys. Not for money, but points, but competitive.
Not for money, everyone, just to...
Not for money, no. For money. The manager didn't want us to... used to say, no one pay for money.
I don't blame him. Mount Ranger, you know why that is. Did you see the effects and how strong, and I mean this in the greatest respect, I don't mean to disrespect him in any capacity, but did you see how incredible Sir Alex Ferguson was when he left? And you have that one season where you're with a different manager, different approach, different beliefs.
You know that saying, you don't know what you got till it's gone?
Mm.
That's it.
Jenny Jackson just playing through your mind.
Yeah, you just, because it's like, when he was there, we used to go, he's lucky, man. He used to make decisions. We used to think, as you, like Darren Gibson started against Bayern Munich at home. He ended up, I think we got beat in the end, yeah?
Yeah.
But he starts, I think we might have gone through. He starts out of nowhere, everyone's in a changing room like that. And his name got called out. Everyone's looking at each other like, right, is Jeremy Beadle going to come out in a minute? Like, is he lying? Then all of a sudden, within about 30 seconds, my man scores the first goal. And you're sitting there thinking, this guy is so lucky. But he ain't. He just smells something.
Scribbs was vexed about him playing. The sort of celebrating. He never even knew that he was vexed about him playing.
Nah, it is mad. And you just think, like, he just made so many decisions like that where you'd think, wow, this guy just got a... He just got a way of just understanding the moment and just knowing what to do. And he was... It weren't till he left that, like, me and Vida especially used to sit there, man, chat, have long, deep chats and just go, rah, he was bad. He was a bad man.
Like, serious?
Yeah, because you're then seeing someone else work in his shoes. And it's unfair, really, on David Moyes, but I think anybody that came in would have struggled.
Yeah, yeah,
100%. Most 99% of the people coming in would have struggled after what he'd done at the club and how he controlled it. But to see it there like that, and then it just enhances everything about him.
What were the distinct differences, though? What were the big differences that you noticed in the approach? Maybe the approach to a game, lead up to a game. What were the differences that...
He cared. David Moyes cared about the opponents.
How is it?
Like, he prepared more for the opponent. Whereas when he was with Sir Alex Ferguson, it's about us.
Mm.
If we are on it, we win. That's it. If we're on it, if you go out there and you run more than them, that's the first thing, and you outwork them, the rest will take care of itself. Run like non-league players, Division 2, Division 3 players, and the quality will come to the top, and you'll win more than you lose. And we wouldn't prepare for a player.
He wasn't interested in any of that.
I don't remember us preparing for a player, other than Pirlo. Don't remember us preparing for a player.
So Ferguson had the confidence in his team to know that, listen, if we do our thing, we don't have to worry about absolutely nothing.
With David Moyes, he was preparing for like Coutinho or Hazard and setting us up to stop them.
So the first time that happens, you're in the chain.
I was looking at, like, what's this?
Serious?
Yeah, everyone's looking at...
Was everybody in the same... So it wasn't like the Alex Ferguson moment where you're by yourself. Everyone's on the same, like, big man, DM, what going?
Yeah, like, a few of us are like, definitely me, like, Nemanja and a few others are going, like, what are you in this? What is this about? Like, what are we doing? Like, we Man United don't worry about these guys. Do you know what I mean? We just go and play our game. And when they come into certain areas, then we try and get to them. And it just, that mentality, that mindset, I think you go into a game already at a loss. You're starting from a lower place when you think like that, because you're already thinking negative. Like, what can he do? What he's capable of? Building him up to be met like Diego Maradona before you even start. You're on the back foot. Whereas before it was just like, we control this game, we control the ball. So don't play it like that sometimes, but that's our mentality going in.
Do you think that's that elite mentality? Because obviously, you know, you've played for so long, BT correspondent now. Now you're watching the game, you're analysing it from a different perspective. Do you see that maybe that sort of elite mentality within the change room maybe coming back now, but hadn't been there for a little while, and that's the reasons why there was sort of a weird spell for Manchester United? Obviously, they finished second this season, but
I don't think it's not about just the players. I think it was the club. Mm-hmm. Just lost that kind of elite mentality. It's qualified for the Champions League. That weren't like qualifying for the Champions League and not winning anything was a failure in our time. But it's different times, and you've got to get away from comparing it to the old times. But that was our culture built on success, where they're trying to build that culture now because they lost it. So it's hard to do that, but you've got to add the right pieces to start building that culture as well. And the manager's got to build that culture. So Alex Ferguson created the culture at the football club. Then he had lieutenants underneath that carrying it out and keeping that going. They need to formulate that now still, I think.
Real, I could talk to you about football forever. But, I'm trying to think, is there any, because, man.
I've got to come back when you lot do the shows, man. Because yeah, when you lot do the shows, like,
because you messaged me and I thought you were going to come in for Filthy at Five at one point.
Yeah, I couldn't come in though. But yeah, definitely next time. The next season, they'll try to get something in the diary. Because some of the stuff I was hearing was...
Give us a name of someone where you're just like, what are you talking about? It can't even be me.
I can't remember. Who is it?
Lippy? Marks?
Lippy makes me laugh, to be
fair. It's too funny, isn't it?
He's funny. He does say some funny stuff, but... No, there's... I don't know. I can't remember. But I remember texting you thinking, right, I would love to be there now.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we'll do something, man.
All right, well, you heard it here. Rio's coming. What subject area do you mind being a part of, and what... Nah, I don't want to be a part of that. Maybe if you talk about defensive or...
Yeah, let's talk about defenders. That's what I'm passionate about, isn't it?
And you're there?
Yeah.
You said it on camera, big man. We're going to clip that and send it to the whole world. All the blogs, grab that for us, please. Rio Fernandes coming to talk about defenders and Filthy Five. But thank you for coming down, my G.
Nice to see you, man. Love
you. Always a pleasure. He's also going to be giving me a diet requirement, because as you can see, my arms and his arms are massive, bro. I really want to go gym and get wedged now.
You got to eat. I told you that. You got to eat enough food.
I do. I'm not Specs, you know. Specs has Haribos for dinner.
No, but that's not... You could eat 100 packs of them, but that's not the food to get gain weight.
I eat. Last night, we were in a Bad Boy restaurant, Dirty Bones.
Yeah, but Specs is mager.
Exactly. I'm not like that. I actually eat, but nothing happens. The watch can't fit properly. The ring can't fit properly. It's like a howler for me.
Whoa. Do you run about all day?
Oh, yeah. I'm outside now.
See,
I'm
that's outside. What I mean. That's part of it. You got to chill a little bit, maybe.
Yeah, we chilled for an... Rio, you're taking me gym. Love everyone. Cool. Done, no.